Well, our story kind of started with the fact that Nathan and I grew up together, different friends, different groups, but we grew up together, graduated from the same high school, Melito, and a few years ago we bumped into each other at another classmate's wedding, and I hadn't seen him since he graduated from high school, we graduated from high school, and it just seemed to click, and I just think it's been amazing. It's been an amazing ride because he is everything that I've ever wanted, and it's been a long time that I wanted to find someone like this, and for me to find someone that I grew up with in my hometown is just really insane. When I tell people our story, they say it's like a movie. And the funny thing is I remember telling someone one time, I'm like, I don't want to just date someone where it's just, oh, this is comfortable. This is a person that, yeah, we get along. We had that click from the beginning. And I think that's what's pretty cool. So, what was it like for you?
Well, I knew that when we ran into each other at the first time at Stacy's wedding, that I was there with Calissa, and you were there by yourself.
Oh yeah.
And so I was sat at a table of people that I didn't know anybody, and so I saw that at her table that they had a couple opening seats, and so I went over there and sat with them instead. So we ended up striking up a conversation and talking that whole evening. And I gave her my email address because she said she had taken photos and she wanted to send those photos to me. So I hadn't checked my email for a good 2 or 3 months after that. And I finally looked it up one day, and there was an email in there from Sharon. And so I looked at the photos she had sent, and she had given me her phone number. So I went ahead and just gave her a call up and said, "What are you doing?" And she said, "I'm getting ready to watch Family Guy."
Yeah. But first I said, "Who is this?"
Oh, yeah.
Because I had totally written him off. I figured, oh, because we were at our 15-year high school reunion and he had brought his girlfriend. And so when I saw that he had his girlfriend, I'm like, oh, forget it. Yeah. And then he called me up one night.
She said she was getting ready to watch the show. And so I said, "Well, you want me to come over and watch it with you?" And she goes, "Yeah." So I went over there at 1 o'clock in the morning.
We hung out and watched Family Guy with a friend of ours, and who was with me visiting. And then I remember all this time I'd been saying I want to get a serious relationship. And when he started asking me, he's like, "What do you think about us dating?" And I'm like, "Can we just date?" Because I wasn't sure. I'm like, "This is a little weird. I grew up with you. Like, I don't know." And what I realized was, he goes, "Okay," and we were hanging out with some friends another night, and I thought to myself, I said, "You know what, if I just want a date, I might lose him," and it was a really great opportunity. And so I said, "Okay, let's see how it goes," and we've been together ever since.
Yeah.
And he is one of the most loving men I've ever met. He is one of the most generous. He is the type of guy I can go anywhere say, "I don't know anybody except for maybe one person," and he'll say, "Okay, nah." He'll come home and have, like, we've got 40 friends now that we need to invite to their functions. He is the type of person that can hold his own and meet so many people, and I love that about him. He's very generous, very loving, a great dad to Calissa, and I couldn't have asked for a better guy to get married to, because we still hold hands on a regular basis when we go to sleep at night, and I think that's awesome because it just really shows that we just care about each other so much. And I just feel very blessed.
Thank you. First of all, I want to welcome all of you here this afternoon to join together the renewal of vows between Nathan and Sharon. It was almost 1 year ago that the two of you, in a private ceremony with your immediate family, made your commitment to each other before God and one another and the state of marriage. And today we have the privilege in a more public ceremony in front of your, not just your family, but your extended friends to be able to share this day together. The Bible teaches us, Nathan and Sharon, that marriage is a holy institution. It is established in heaven by the divine kindness and wisdom of God, who after creating Adam looked upon him and said, "It is not good that man should be alone." It was then from Adam that God created Eve. She was not created out of his head to be over him, nor was she created out of his feet to be under him. But she was created near his side to be loved by him, under his arm to be protected by him, and near to his heart to be loved by him. When the Lord looked upon Adam and Eve, he said, "These two shall become one." Jesus likewise affirmed the value of marriage in the New Testament when he says, "For this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. What God has joined together," said Jesus, "let no one separate." From these verses in both the Old and the New Testaments, we learn that marriage is a sacred union between two individuals. God's intention for marriage is that it is a timeless commitment that is till death separates the two of you. But not just his intention for marriage that you make a lifelong commitment, but the Lord intends for marriage to be a sacred act where the two of you grow in your relationship with him and with each other. His desire for marriage is not just happiness, but also holiness. With that in mind, the two of you, as you make the commitment today or reaffirm your commitment to become one flesh as husband and wife, you are renewing your vows of your intention not just to stay together till death do you part, but you are reaffirming your desire to grow and to mature in one another, that hopefully your love is going to grow over the course of time. Marriage is a beautiful rite which is ordained and blessed by God. And as we enter this time of renewal today, we're going to ask you to do a series of vows. And the first set of vows is simply affirming your desire for marriage in the presence of your family and God Almighty. I'll start with you, Nathan. Nathan, will you have this woman, Sharon, to be your wife, to live together after God's holy ordinance in the holy state of matrimony? Will you love her? Will you comfort her and honor and keep her in sickness and in health and forsaking all others as long as you both shall live?
I will.
And Sharon, will you have this man to be your husband, to live together after God's holy ordinance in the holy state of matrimony? Will you love him, comfort him, honor and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, stay faithful to him as long as you both shall live? Now the two of you have declared your vows before us, we're going to ask you to share your vows one to another. So Nathan, you can now take Sharon's hand in yours and repeat after me. I, Nathan.
I, Nathan.
Take you, Sharon.
Take you, Sharon.
To be my wife.
To be my wife.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
For richer or for poor.
For richer or for poor.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death separates us.
Till death separates us.
I pledge you my love.
I pledge you my love.
This day.
This day.
And forevermore.
Forevermore.
Now, Sharon, would you share your vows? I, Sharon.
I, Sharon.
Take you, Nathan.
Take you, Nathan.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
For richer or for poor.
For richer or for poor.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death separates us.
Till death separates us.
I pledge you my love.
I pledge you my love.
This day.
This day.
And forevermore.
And forevermore.
Would you now join us as we have a reading from Heather. She is going to be reading the scripture from the book of Colossians, chapter number 3, verses 12 and following.
Put on then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against one another, forgiving each other. So you also must forgive. And above all these things, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him.
All around us we see symbols, Symbols, in most cases, are physical, sometimes material objects that represent something greater than themselves. These symbols stand for something, they represent something, and they communicate something that is greater than themselves. It can be a cross on a church, a logo on a business, it can be a date in history, a story, a wink of an eye. These are all examples of how words, actions, or physical items can represent a truth or a reality greater than themselves. We read in the scripture the importance of symbols throughout. Obviously, Jesus and his crucifixion upon the cross. The cross has become a symbol of the death and the resurrection of Jesus. But also we read in the Old Testament that after the Lord had destroyed the world by flood, that he put a rainbow in the sky, and he told Noah that he would put a rainbow there to remind him and the people of all generations that he would never again destroy the world by flood. The rainbow serves as a token, a reminder of the commitment that God made to us as people, and it serves as a commitment, a reminder that it is well for us when we enter into sacred unions to set aside reminders. We are now going to set aside a few symbolic acts that represent the commitment the two of you are making today. Already you have exchanged your rings last year at your wedding service that we had, but today we're going to reaffirm and say a blessing over your rings. We're then going to have the two of you light the unity candles that has been lit in these individual candles that were lit by your each families, individual families. Lighting the one in the middle represents the fact that you are now meshing your lights together as husband and wife. So as we prepare for these sacred acts, the rings that you have chosen are an endless circle until separated or broken by some outside force, and they serve as the unbroken union that should exist in marriage until separated or broken only by death. Let me now pray for the two of you. I'd like to ask all of you to join us as we pray. And immediately following this, the two of you will light your unity candle and then greet your families. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for Nathan and Sharon. I thank you for bringing them together. I thank you for their great love for each other. I thank you for this past year that they've had and the great future they have in front of them. I ask, Lord Jesus, that you help them to both continue to grow in their relationship one to another and their relationship with you. I pray, dear God, that you will bless them, that you will strengthen them during the challenges and the difficulties that lie in front of them, and that they may be able to enjoy their life together. I ask, Lord, you bless them greatly, that they may be able to make it through whatever challenges and temptations that lie ahead, but also that they will grow in happiness and fulfillment with one another, but also that they will continue to grow spiritually in their relationship with you. We ask your blessings to be upon them. We thank you for this opportunity to share this beautiful day, Lord, with their family and their friends. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Let me just now share a few words with just the two of you. As we shared a year ago at your wedding service there at Jumer's, I told the two of you then that as much as you love each other and excited as you are to be married, that emotion and passion alone is not enough to sustain a relationship. Our emotions come and our emotions go. And right now that you are so desperately in love with each other and you're together in love, it's always an exciting time. But as we go to the future, those emotions will come and they will go, they will fluctuate, they will be up and they will be down. It doesn't matter who we are, sometimes our emotions are unexplainable, and sometimes our emotions, we just don't understand why we feel the way that we feel. And it's for that reason in the Bible, the scripture gives us another model of love. And the scripture tells us that really love, the kind of love that God models and calls us to exercise in marriage, is a love that is based upon choice and commitment, not just feelings. And when we choose to love the other person and we commit to loving the other person, even when they're not always lovable, what often happens is those feelings follow and they are resurrected and they will be there for the rest of our life. And as I share those things, there's three choices that I want to encourage the two of you to make as you move forward in your marriage. The first is giving. The Bible says it is more blessed to give than it is to receive. Sometimes we feel that is true, and sometimes if we're honest, it's more blessed to receive than it is to give. But the reality is, in a healthy marriage, we are committed to giving. Both of you, early in your relationship, have been very gracious to each other. You're very sensitive to each other. You compliment each other well. But as you move forward, you're going to have to continue to give, not just presents and gifts, but some of the greatest things you're going to give to each other are words. Words like, I'm sorry. Words like, forgive me. Words like, I love you. And so I want to encourage you as you move forward to continue to give to each other and to be patient with each other. And when you get frustrated or you share things to one another, continue to give the gift of love with your words and your touch and your actions. But another thing I want to ask you to commit to is not just giving, but also growing. When something stops growing, it starts dying. It is true of our bodies, it is true of nature, and it also is true of our relationships. So often, unfortunately, in our society, we believe that our wedding day is sort of the end of, and that's as good as it gets. And we think that because we made this commitment, it's going to last. But God's intention for marriage and relationship is that we continue to grow and to mature, that we move beyond the passion of a new relationship to the maturity of a healthy relationship. And so the Bible says this, let those who are wise listen and become even wiser, and let those who understand receive guidance. I pray the two of you will continue to receive guidance, that the two of you will grow in wisdom, that you will grow in understanding each other's love languages, that you will grow in understanding how God desires you to love the other person, that you will grow in forgiveness and in grace and in sacrifice to each other, and that as you die to yourselves and you choose to love each other and you choose to grow as Christians but also in your relationship, that you will find new levels of happiness and contentment in your relationship. So giving, growing, and then the final piece is God. Jesus said, the wise man is the one who hears my words and puts them into practice. But the foolish man, said Jesus, is the one who hears my words and does not put them into practice. The Lord is the one who will give you strength when you are weary. God is the one that will give you perspective when things are blurry. He is the one who will give you hope when things look bleak. He changes our character. He changes our heart. He changes our wills if we allow him. And he becomes the glue that holds our relationship together when the strains and stresses of life come against us. He is the author of life. He is the inventor of marriage. He is God. He has allowed the two of you to connect together, and he has given you this wonderful opportunity of a bright future together. He will not just provide you the hope of heaven, but he wants to lead you, to control you, to guide you, and to bless you for his purposes and his intentions. But he will not force himself upon you. You must choose to seek him. You must choose to serve him. You must choose to submit to him. But when we do, he promises to bless us. And I believe that God becomes the base of a healthy relationship for the two of you, but also any who draw near to him. So with those things being said, giving, growing, and God, I pray you take those to heart. And I pray that as you move forward in the future years of your relationship, you continue to find great levels of happiness in each other, but also that your life becomes a model to others. That they're able to look at Nathan and Sharon and say, I hope to have that, and it's a beautiful thing. So with those things being said, I now have the opportunity for the second time in 1 year, by the authority conferred upon me by the laws of the state of Illinois, now to pronounce the two of you husband and wife. Nathan, you may once again kiss your bride. Allow me to present to all of you, Mr. and Mrs. Nathan and Sharon Hoffman, those who God has joined together. Let them separate.
Thank you. job. Okay. Now run.
Sorry, I had to write a lot of this stuff down. What I remember about him was the first thing I thought was, you know, who is that scary bald-headed guy that keeps asking questions? So, but then again, it was kind of dark in the room, and the days were pretty long, so it wasn't really that scary. The only other guy in the class that stood out was a guy named Angel. He kind of only stood out because he was sleeping through all the classes and always showed up late. So, so once our training was over, they kind of moved the three of us all down about a mile away from the rest of our team. So we kind of knew nothing and had to sit by people who knew nothing. So right off the bat, you know, me and Nate sat right next to each other, started, you know, training, helping with each other, joking around, and kind of making fun of Angel. So it was pretty much from that day on, you know, I knew me and Nate were going to be really good friends. You know, since then, we spent a lot of time together, both, you know, at work and outside of work. And no matter what, I've always been able to count on Nate for a really good laugh. For those of you who don't know, you know, one of the things Nate likes to do to get laughs out of people is he likes to take your picture and cut your head off and put it on bodies of random pictures that he gets off the internet. You know, so, and it's not just random pictures completely, you know, there's always an inside joke that relates to the picture. So, you know, like, you know, about, don't kill me, honey, 4 years ago I got married, and one of the ones they pulled off was a nice couple off the internet, but he decided to stick my head on the bride for some reason. You know, there's another one, I don't even remember what the reason was, but, you know, he stuck my head on a picture of a baby and, you know, in a high chair. And then there was a third one that I'm not going to talk about because that was kind of embarrassing, and we don't even, I hope that one has burnt by now. Yeah, but from, you know, from anything we've ever done, you know, bachelor party, hanging out, and just after work, regular everyday conversation, happy hours after work, I've always been able to count on Nate, just for a good, fun time. And actually, speaking of happy hours, if you guys, anybody wants a really good video of Nate dancing, just hit me up on Facebook, Steve, buy me, friend me, I'll pass it out to you, it's awesome. Called Nate Lord of the Dance. Really good.
Yes!
No, another interesting tidbit about Nate that maybe some of you don't know. He's the only friend of mine that ever comments on my hair. For some reason, I come into work, he'll always comment whether it's too long or too short or just right. And, you know, I spent quite a while a couple of days ago trying to get it just right for him this time. Just for his day, I wanted to make sure it looked good. And I don't know if it's just gives him some kind of nostalgic feeling to talk about hair or something, so. It's not always, you know, all fun and games. So, you know, Nate's got a really big heart, along with commenting on my hair. You know, he was honestly one of the only friends I have that, you know, I hit a couple tough spots in my personal life. He's one of the friends that actually would call me at home, see how I was doing. Try to get me out of the house, you know, come by, hang out, you know, listen to me complain, and really spend time, you know, with me in my situation. You know, he's really, like I said, he's got a big heart. He generally cared about what I was going through and tried to help me through it. And, you know, that's probably the best thing I love about him. You know, he really cares about, you know, family, and friendship is extremely important to the guy. So, thank you. You know, I'm Sharon. I'll be nice. I mean, I haven't spent as much time as I would like with Sharon. I met her about a year and a half ago. We've had a lot of fun together. And, you know, what I'll tell you about her is she's a very level-headed, down-to-earth girl. Great just to hang out with, talk with. You know, doesn't seem to have a bad moment in her body, so I think she's still kind of hiding something. But, you know, the best part about her, though, is she can put up with all of Nate's shenanigans and all of Nate's friends' shenanigans, and even Corey's shoes, which is beyond me. So, you know, we had a lot of fun. We go on an annual float trip in the last couple of years. We've had a lot of fun together. But I can't really tell you any of those stories because she'd probably get up here and tackle me. So I'll just say we had a lot of fun together. But again, I hate to be redundant. You know, same thing with Nate. You know, Sharon really takes family and friendship to heart. It's truly important, you know, in her life. And for that, you know, that's why these two make a great couple. So, you know, everybody raise your glasses. Nate, Sharon, you know, from the bottom of my heart, I wish you two lifelong love and happiness. Congratulations.
Yeehaw! Sharon, Nathan. Sharon, you're my older sister. I love you. You always made me very proud. And I've always wanted every happiness for you, so I'm so thankful and so happy for you that you found your soulmate, your true love. I remember when Sharon called me and was telling me about a good friend's wedding and how she met someone there. She had a blast with him and his daughter, and that someone was you, Nathan. It took some time for them to have their first date, but when they did, Sharon had called me and was just talking up a storm about how much fun they had and everything, and it was just, I was just ecstatic for her. She had found someone, and I was so happy. But since that first date, you both have grown into an amazing couple and are sure to have an equally amazing life together. So, raise your glass. Congratulations to you both. I'm so very happy for you guys, and welcome to the family, Nathan. Gave me the mic because he said, I know you can talk a lot, so I don't know what he's talking about. So apparently I can talk really loud too. Alright, Nathan was gracious enough. A year ago we got married and I said, okay, we'll do the immediate family members and we'll get married. We wanted to be together as soon as possible because we hated being apart. We lived in two different towns and we wanted to be together, but we couldn't afford the big wedding. And I said, we'll do the small wedding, have our immediate family members there, but I want to wear the white dress, so I don't care. I want to have the party, I want to have the wedding. And he said, okay. So he was gracious enough to let me have two. But we are just so happy that our friends and family could be here today. I just was hoping and praying and trusting that God was going to bring someone in my life who really understood me and put up with me and my talking, and I found him. But I'm so okay. You RS people are there. Stop it. But we just are so grateful and thankful for you guys to be here today to share this birthday with us. And we just hope you have a great time tonight. And I'm going to hand the mic over to Nate because I'm going to keep talking if I don't.
Well, I'm going to do this for Corey because he loves this. Take a look after weather forecast with us this afternoon. Or the farm report, yeah. Now, really, thank you all for coming. I know a lot of you guys traveled some good distances to get here and be here, and it means a lot to both of us that you get to share this day and be a part of it with us. So, Sharon, yeah, the whole talking thing, she's pretty dead on. I've learned a technique. It's they stare and just stare. So it does work. She thinks I'm listening. And then at the end she goes, at the end I go, what? So.
It just makes you start over again.
There you go. Then I have to hear it again, so. But no, thank you again. I really appreciate that you could all be here. So, thanks again.
cheer for the bride and the groom. Congratulations. Please come out and join in dancing. All the wedding party, please come out and join in dancing.
Daughter, I see the trees are green, red and soul.